Good morning. I always appreciate the opportunity to come and to speak with you all, and I look forward to it every chance I get, even though it makes me incredibly nervous. I'm not sure if I'll ever get over the fear of public speaking, but here we are. The more you do it, the more the better you get at it, right? This morning, I want to talk to you for just a few little moments about the sacredness of the mind, the sacredness of the mind. I know it's been 15 years, but it doesn't seem like it, but I was once sitting where you are in college, and I remember being a wide-eyed, bright, 18-year-old young man setting off to college for my first time, being alone without my parents, off on my own, making my own decisions, learning and using my own brain for the first time really ever. In my first class I remember sitting in, looked something like this. Thankfully, there's not many classes here at Faulkner, I don't know of any that seat 200 people, but this was my experience in freshman biology at a large public university. I was one of, 200, 300 people in the room, and we were all sitting there hoping to learn something from this person standing in front of us with a lot of letters after their name who was very accomplished in their field. And I remember sitting there as one of the very first lectures I heard as a college student dealt with this. The Big Bang Theory. Not just a TV show. There's an actual theory behind this that scientists use to put forward that this is how the world began, the universe began. Everything in it came from an infinitesimally small dot contained with matter that was infinitely large. So think about the entire universe fitting on the head of a pin. That's what scientists would have you believe. And this was put forward to me in a very convincing way, a way that made a lot of sense, a way that spoke to me. Later on this semester, we moved forward and we talked about the Miller-Urey experiment, the idea that the primordial Earth, whenever it was first formed, was not like we have it today, and this idea that the gases and the chemicals were such that with the right amount of energy, with the right amount of electrical activity, that life could come from non-life. Again, presented in a very convincing way and something that I kind of started to wonder about. As we moved on through the semester, we began to look at the different anatomies of different animals, and we began to notice how humans and cats and whales and bats are all kind of built the same. They call this comparative anatomy. My wife, actually, when she was at Auburn, she took an entire class, an entire semester on comparative anatomy, looking at the similarities between animals and how things are connected together. And scientists will use this to prove that we all are descended from a common ancestor, the idea that we evolved from a single source. And as I was going throughout that semester, and as I left, and I remember going back home over Christmas break, I had a lot of questions. You could even say I had a lot of doubt. You see, I'd grown up being taught and believing that God was real, that he created everything, that Jesus was his son, and that he was sent to earth, and that he died and was crucified. And I knew all of that. I'd been taught it from a very early age. But what I figured out was I didn't know why I believed that. I had believed it just simply because I did. And because I didn't have a firm foundation and it hadn't reasoned through and hadn't thought about why I believed what I believed, I left my first semester freshman year. I think, generously, I would call myself a skeptic at that point. I wasn't a full-blown agnostic or an atheist, not yet anyway, but I was headed that direction. But I definitely had a lot of doubt. And as I look across the room now, I see a lot of people that were of similar age that I was at that time. I think it would be naive of us to think that you're not experiencing some doubt yourself. Maybe you've asked those questions. You've seen the evidence just like I saw the evidence, and you're starting to wonder, is God real? Or did we just come from the Big Bang? Did life evolve from non-life? There's experiments, and scientists have plenty of theories to describe that. Did we evolve from a common ancestor? Again, a lot of support there. So maybe you're asking those questions too, like I was. Where did we come from? Where are we going? Why are we here? I had lots of questions. I still do, by the way. I still have lots of questions. But maybe you have questions too. And I think that's okay. That's one of the points that I wanted to talk about today, that having doubt, having questions, it's okay. It's only okay, though, if we're doing something about it. You see, doubt for me set me on this journey, and I'm still on that journey today, but really over the next 5 years, I started seeking answers for these questions. I started going out trying to make sense of it all. I remember leaving that lecture hall for that last class and thinking, my world's been turned upside down. What is up? What's down? I don't know anymore. Everything that I had held so dear had been shaken. And so if you're in that position too, and I would encourage you to take the words of Christ found here in Matthew chapter 7. It reads, "Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. And the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks it will be opened." See, Christ wants us to ask those questions. He wants us to seek to find those answers. He wants us to use our minds to seek Him. And we can seek that in God's Word, but really, I would encourage you also to look at His creation. In Paul's letter to the Romans in chapter 1, verse 20, it reads, "For His invisible attributes, namely His eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world, and the things that have been made so that they are without excuse." What he's saying there is that if we want to know more about God, sure, we can examine His Word, and we ought to, but also we can examine His creation. We can look at what God made. His fingerprints are all over creation. And if we take the time to ask those questions and to examine it, I think we can start to deal with some of those tough questions. In Matthew and Mark, there's a parallel statement that Christ makes. He's reflecting the greatest command from God. And he says that you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your mind. And I think a lot of times we skip over this last part of the command about loving God with all of your mind. What does that mean, to love God with all your mind? I submit to you that that does not mean that we ought to have a blind faith. Apologies to anybody that has ever told you that you just have to have faith, that that's enough. I think they're wrong. Faith is important, don't get me wrong, and faith is what I've built my life on. But I've also built my life on reason and logic. I've asked those tough questions, I've reasoned through things, I've looked at the evidence, and I've tried my best to make it make sense to me. You see, God gave us these incredible brains. We have the ability to process all kinds of information, to reason, to look at the evidence, to examine things. It's what separates us from the rest of the animal kingdom. This idea that we can actually look at things and make choices and make decisions. We're not just creatures that are solely relying on our instincts. We have the ability to really think. And I think that makes us unique in the animal kingdom. And so to love God with all of our mind, I think it's not just about loving Him with our heart and loving Him with our soul. We ought to do those things too, of course. But we have to take the time to love Him with our mind as well. How do we do that? In Romans chapter 12, verse 2, I think Paul gives us an answer to how we love God with all of our mind. It reads, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect." So how do we love God with our whole mind? We test. We discern. That word discern, I think, is a great word. It means choosing between two choices, choosing between this or that, and being able to make that informed decision and reasoning our way through the evidence to discern right from wrong, from truth or fiction. And I think that's something that we are all called to do. In fact, I know it is. In Paul's letter to the Philippians, he's leaving them. He had left them, but he was worried that what he was leaving behind was his own faith, was Paul's faith. And he was encouraging the Philippians to work out their own salvation. And I think that's something that we all have to face. That was what I was facing whenever I was leaving my freshman year of college. I was in this problem because I did not have my own salvation. If I'm honest, I had maybe my parents' salvation. I might have had my preacher's salvation. I'd sat through, by that point, so many sermons, so many lessons, so many Bible classes, but I'd never really taken the time to make it make sense for me. Maybe you're at that point, or maybe you're not even have gotten to that point to where you're not asking those questions. So first, I would encourage you to ask those questions, those important questions. Why are we here? Where are we going? Where did we come from? And then don't stop there, though. If you have that doubt, that's good. Use that doubt as motivation to go and try to find those answers. And that's something that I had to do for myself, but I think it's something that we all have to do. Real quickly, as I close here, I don't want to leave you with the idea of thinking that I still believe all the things that I believed whenever I was an 18-year-old freshman in college. And I'm going to share with you my reasons, just three short ones. There are many more that I could talk about. I love this subject, and I think it's one of the greatest things that we can do is to look at the evidence, examine it, and reason through God. But I'm going to share with you three short reasons why I believe in God. The first one is this simple fact that something can't come from nothing. Think about that for a second. Let's suppose for a moment that this were true. It's not, but let's suppose for a moment that it is. Big Bang Theory, right? Everything in the universe came from a small dot of matter. Remember, it can fit on the end of a pen. My question to that I cannot wrap my head around is, where did that dot come from? If we believe in the laws of nature, and I do, I think the laws of nature are enforced. I think God created them. But there is no law of nature that says that something can come from nothing. And so at some point, even if the Big Bang were true, there had to have been something to put that something there. It can't come from nothing. Something can't come from nothing. But let's skip that for a second. Let's assume and move on to the next problem that I have, and that is that life cannot come from non-life. So let's assume that the Big Bang Theory happened, that the Earth was formed, and then it has the prehistoric conditions, and we come to this Miller-Urey experiment that I talked about earlier. As I continued my studies, I learned more and more about this, and what I learned is that this experiment was conducted in the 50s and has yet to be replicated, meaning that other scientists have tried to reproduce these conditions and tried to achieve these same results, and they couldn't. There are a lot of theories about how life came from non-life and how the first single-celled organism happened. But that's just it. They're all theories. To this point, science cannot provide us with an answer of how life started. I don't think they ever will, because I don't think life came from non-life. I think God created life. It makes the most sense that there is a creator. And then the last point here, and this one is a big one for me, because if you ever have the opportunity to take a science class from a university or a school that does not profess Christ or does not profess God, you're going to learn about evolution, and you're going to learn a lot about it, because that is the leading theory for how humans evolved into their current state. But as I started to examine the evidence and started to ask these questions for myself, I started to realize that it doesn't make sense to me. It just doesn't. This comparative anatomy that we talked about earlier. Okay, you say that it came from a common ancestor. What about a common creator? Wouldn't we expect a common creator to have similar styles, similar mechanisms for creating things? If you look at an artist, you can kind of notice that and tell that which artist drew that picture because of the distinct brush strokes, the distinct colors that they're using. So if you look at God, wouldn't we expect him to use the similar things? Alternatively, how many ways can a hand be connected to a wrist, be connected to an arm? This might be the best way. In fact, I think it is, because God created it, right? But moving beyond that, moving into the idea of evolution itself, the premise of evolution is built around the idea that random happenings, genetic mutations, are responsible for the diversity of life that we see around us in this world. And that just doesn't make sense to me. I look at the cosmos, right? You think about, we're sitting on a rock that's rotating around a star, which is rotating throughout a galaxy of thousands and millions of other galaxies. I mean, the scale is just enormous, and all the complexity and the order that exists. It's incredible to think about. And if you zoom in really close, we're all made up of atoms, of electrons rotating around protons and neutrons, and those combine together different types of atoms to make different things and eventually get to a cell. What evolutionary biologists would have you believe is that an analogy that you commonly hear is, if I were to take the components of a finely handcrafted watch, if I took each one of the individual components and put them into a box and then took that box and shook it really hard, how long would it have to take before those pieces would randomly assemble into that watch? I'm here to tell you that it wouldn't happen. I can't make it make sense that it would happen. And how much more intricate is a single cell than one watch? How long will we have to shake that box to come up with one cell? How long will we have to shake that cell to come up with us? It just doesn't make sense to me. All the random happenstance that is needed in order for evolutionary biology to be true, I'll be frank with you. I think it takes more faith to believe in evolution than it does to believe in a creator that created life. Because you have to have faith that all of those happenstance, all of those random occurrences worked out just right. That you rolled the dice and every single time it came up the right way. I'm not sure about you, but I can't make that make sense. And so as I'm standing before you today, having examined the evidence, I believe that I understand, and the best way of understanding what's going on around me, of making sense of everything, is that there is an intelligent designer that has created everything. That he created the world. He created the universe and everything in it. And to me, that just makes the most sense. It's not because I have this blind faith anymore. I once did, but now I don't. I have a well-reasoned faith. And I encourage you to develop a well-reasoned faith. You've heard about the analogy that Christ gives about the man who built his house on the sand. And what happens to the sand, to the house, once the storm comes along? Of course, it comes crashing down. It goes splat, if you're familiar with the song. And I think if you have a blind faith, if you're waiting to put together the pieces in your brain, that's exactly what you have, is you have a house that's been built on the sand. And that's what I had whenever I first went to school. The first time that a storm came along in the form of a biology 101, my house went splat and sent me scrambling. And it was at that point that I began to take the other road and become the other man that built my house on the rock. And in order to do that, you have to dig deep. You have to dig down to the rock. It takes work. It takes effort. It's not going to come to you. These answers aren't just going to appear in front of you. It takes effort. It takes work. You have to go and seek and find. But here's the whole moral of the story. You don't have to take my word for it. I would encourage you to examine the evidence, to dig deep into God's word, to look at his creation, to look at what science has to say, to consider alternative perspectives like we're doing this entire semester, to look at the world from a different point of view, to try to reason those tough questions. I would encourage you to ask those tough questions, but I would also encourage you to seek and not stop asking questions until you find answers that make sense to you. And so hopefully, if somebody's here that is in that situation, that is having doubt, that is having some skepticism, just know that you're not alone. We all do that. I'm reminded of the man that Christ was healing his son that had an unclean spirit, and Christ is admonishing him for his lack of faith, and the man cries out, "I believe, but help my unbelief." That's the prayer that I have every single day. And I would encourage you to pray that prayer with me as well. If you have any questions and you're not finding the answers, come and find me. Come and find any of your professors. They would love nothing more than the opportunity to speak to you about these, to help you find those answers, to help you reason to the truth. Because I firmly believe that if you ask the right questions and you examine the right evidence, you're going to come to the knowledge of the truth, that God is who he is, that Jesus is his son, that he came to this world, that he died, so that we might have the opportunity and the hope of eternal life.